Good morning and welcome to the 14th meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. We've received apologies from Mark Griffin for today's meeting. May I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take item 3 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on damp and mould in social and private rented housing from two separate panels of witnesses. On panel one, we're joined by Rosemary Agnew, Ombudsman from the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman, Callum Homchuk, who's the National Director of Chartered Institute of Housing Scotland, Nicola Harkus, who's the Assistant Director of Regulations, Scottish Housing Regulator, and Helen Shaw, who's the Director of Regulations, Scottish Housing Regulator. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. And I will begin with questions. So this one's for everybody, but again, you don't have to come in on everything, and I think we've got some specific questions that relate to your specific work. But I'd be interested to get your sense of the scale of the problem of dampness and mould in rented housing. For example, is it more prevalent in a particular housing type or a geographical area? And do you think data in this area could be improved? And maybe I'll start with Callum.
Thanks, convener. So I think the scale of the problem is quite hard to tell. I think you've heard this in previous sessions. I would also, however, stress that it is an absolute priority for the sector to focus on the kind of the instances of damp and mould that are appearing and are being presented to landlords across the sector. I think what we've found over certainly the last recent months, but before that, is that landlords are doing more and more to try and measure the scale of the problem to understand the state and of their housing stock across Scotland. So we're seeing landlords reflecting more on previous customer complaints, looking at patterns of complaints to understand actually are there kind of instances of damp and mould. We're finding more systemising of data collection. So we're finding landlords trying to repeat more tenant surveys to understand actually what instances of damp and mould, not always requiring customers to come forward with instances, but actually look at kind of systematic ways to capture data. And again, looking at things like digital monitoring and technology to try and capture that. We don't have a complete picture. I think the committee's heard that in previous weeks. So I don't think we can say with confidence the absolute scale of the kind of prevalence. But what I do say is the sector is taking steps to understand it much more deeply and respond to it appropriately. And I think we'll probably get into some of the responses to that later.
Thanks very much for that. And it sounds like that's a good approach, that systematic approach. Certainly, I've come across constituents who I don't think they... You know, the challenge of the situation is so strong on their mental health that they're not necessarily going to come forward with the issue. So it sounds good that that is approached. Rosemary, in your work, have you got a sense of the scale of the problem from people coming to you?
I think I'd echo what Callum said. The statistics on it are quite low, but there are some things that we can identify. We started... recently actually logging complaints specifically as mould or damp, whereas up to last year they were generally within housing repairs. And what we have gone back and looked at is, although the numbers are small, there were 7 last year where we'd either logged them or we'd identify mould and damp as an issue. Now, compare that to this year, since April, there have been 10 already. Now, what we are not able to identify are specific themes, but echoing something that Callum said, there are some general points emerging in relation to complaints, and that is these are often cases that are resolved rather than investigated. Bear in mind, I'm specifically looking at it with an RSL or a local authority focus, but they tend to get fixed. A phone call and it tends to get fixed or further monitoring taken. So they're less likely to appear in investigation statistics, which suggests to me that landlords are taking it seriously. Individual cases, they have varied, but there are occasions where it's, I hate the phrase, it's tagged as a lifestyle issue. It might be the amount of washing, showering, whatever. Some of it is that, but there are cases we've seen where people have been moved from housing because the problem has just been basically intractable. I think it is being taken seriously, and we are sensing a shift to giving this more priority. But from the physical building point of view, I think there's probably more to be done. More interesting, I think, for us has been we looked at our data on welfare fund applications. So these were where there were appeals to applications to the Scottish Welfare Fund. Now, this was a little more tricky because we don't track these specifically. But what we've noticed was there were seven cases where it was the experience and impact of mould and damp on a family where they've got poor financial resilience, so likely to be in more specific demographic rather than geographic areas, I would say. They're not all registered social landlords and that, but what the claims to the fund have been about is things like a one-off leak has caused mould as an ongoing thing. So it might be mouldy bedding, mouldy clothing, and when you've got low financial resilience, you're probably struggling to pay your bills. The cost of living's going up. You're probably struggling to pay for food, and you won't have your heating on all the time. It's that impact that I don't think particularly gets picked up in the same way. So for me, there is definitely understand the structural things. Is it the type of building, or is it what's been done to it? But the people side of it probably needs more exploration, I would say.
Right, thanks very much for that. And Helen, from your perspective, this the same question, that do we have a sense of the scale, and do you get a sense that it might be in a particular type of housing, a geographical area? Or I've even been thinking, not necessarily even a geographical area, but even the ground the houses are built on, or maybe the way in which they're built.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, I would echo very much what Callum and Rosemary are saying. It is quite difficult to determine the scale of the problem, because there isn't any national or direct measurement specifically of the instance of mould and damp in properties. And our role is in relation to social landlords, so both local authorities and RSLs. But I think the fundamental role of social landlords is to provide tenants with homes that are safe to live in. And our regulatory standards and requirements are also very much focused on ensuring that social landlords are delivering good outcomes for tenants. So in terms of stock quality, our focus is on monitoring landlords' performance against the Scottish Housing Quality Standard. And while there are references in there about properties meeting the tolerable standard, being free from serious disrepair, making sure that all properties are energy efficient and have modern facilities and are healthy, safe and secure. So it's quite hard to look at these and then think that it would be reasonable for properties to be or acceptable for properties to be experiencing mould and damp. In terms of the statistics that we get from landlords, we know that at March last year, 75% of all social landlords' homes met the Scottish Housing Quality Standard. And that was a dip in performance from the previous year. And the part of the reason that landlords are telling us they weren't compliant with those with SHQS was around other issues other than mould and damp, to do with things like the introduction of new requirements around the electrical installation certificate testing and the linked smoke and heat detectors. So we are just about to receive the next round of the annual return on the charter from landlords at the end of this month. And so we will have a clearer picture from that data about what progress landlords have made in terms of bringing their properties up to the SHQS.
Thanks. I'm just going to take another, while I'm with Helen, I'll come back to you, Callum. You mentioned the Scottish Housing Quality Standard, and then there's also we've got the Scottish Social Housing Charter. And I'd be interested to know if you are considering any more specific monitoring about the prevalence of damp and mould in social housing. Do you think we should be doing that?
We're doing a number of things. We are required every 5 years to review our regulatory framework. So we have commenced this year a review of our regulatory framework. And one of the things that we're looking at as part of that, we'd already identified that we felt that there was a potential gap in some of the data that we collect in relation to tenant and resident safety more generally. In light of some of the events over the last few months, we've been looking specifically at what potential indicators we could collect in relation to monitoring progress with mould and damp. We will be consulting with stakeholders on our proposals around about that, and that will include opportunities for tenants and landlords to give us their views on what would be appropriate indicators. Our thinking is probably around about how quickly landlords respond to issues of mould and damp, and how quickly landlords rectify the problems that are being identified. That's our current thinking, but obviously we will be consulting with the sector over the next few months around about that, and we'll be very interested to hear tenants and landlords' views about what's the best way for us to do that.
Great, thanks for that. Yes, yeah, speed does seem to be quite an important one, but good to be consulting with everybody. Callum, you wanted to come back.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I just wanted to add to Helen's point around the kind of prevalence. While obviously the last 6 months, 8 months, we've had a lot of attention, quite rightly, on damp and mould, we've saw a kind of number of media reports around and FOIs conducted that kind of suggests a kind of a real increase in prevalence. I don't think we can necessarily make that assumption. I think it's encouraging tenants to come forward, perhaps in the way they weren't. And I think that's back to my earlier points. I think that's why it's incredibly important that the sector can systemise its approach to ensure that we're capturing data, not waiting for customers and tenants to come forward, but finding a way to collect that data and respond to it in a timely and a preventative way. So I think some of the headlines can look quite alarming that we're seeing double digits increase in prevalence. We shouldn't be seeing damp and mould. I think the sector's commitment we want to kind of eliminate as far as practically possible. But I just don't think necessarily the figures suggest it's changed in a lot of ways. We need to get back and actually respond to the root cause of damp and mould. And I think that's what landlords are looking to do.
OK, great. Thanks very much for that. Maybe this question has kind of been answered in what you just said. So the Housing Ombudsman had a follow-up report on dampness in English social housing, and noted that one clear area that landlords in England needed to improve in their knowledge is of their stock. How do social landlords currently monitor dampness problems in their properties in Scotland? And are you content with that social landlords know their stock well enough to take proactive action to deal with the potential dampness and problem? But I think that's what you're saying is now there's a move to systematise and be more proactive on that.
There is, Convener. So I think we are taking a lot of steps across the sector, and we'll continue to do so. And I think that's where the steps are taken will not be sufficient. We'll need to kind of adapt and respond to that as we go on. I do think there are obviously more. That's just about measuring the stock quality a lot, but that's measuring the scale of the problem. I think there's a second part to that. It's about then addressing that fundamental problem. What are the root causes? Are we entering homes often enough? Are we using kind of skilled consultants and contractors or specialists in damp and mould? You know, are we ensuring that the tenants are able to heat their homes properly to kind of address instances of damp mould? There's a lot more in the response that we can still continue to do as well. But I do think we are starting to make kind of headway and actually kind of monitoring the stock in a more thoughtful way.
Thanks very much for that. Rosemary or Helen, do you have any more thoughts to add? Helen?
If I could just add a couple of things to echo what Callum was saying. In light of the events down in Rochdale last year, we wrote to all social landlords before Christmas, and I think we shared that letter with the committee. The purpose of that letter was very much to emphasise the importance of landlords looking at their systems and satisfying themselves that they had robust processes and systems in place for dealing with any complaints about problems with mould and damp, and to understand what processes and systems they have in place to make sure that these are fixed appropriately. We've asked all social landlords to tell us if they identified any issues with their systems and processes and where those landlords have spoken to us, we're engaging with them to get assurance about the steps they're taking to improve those services. We have also published updated recommended practice and asset management for all social landlords earlier this year, and that is very much focused, as Callum says, and emphasising to landlords that they have good quality, robust information about the condition of their stock, to help that inform their planned maintenance and investment programmes, but also to sit that alongside the information that they have about what their tenants' needs as well. So I think those are both quite important pieces of work.
Thanks very much for that. Rosemary, did you want to come in?
I was just going to add one other thing, and it's about where there is something like a one-off event or it's something that can be fixed. Mm. There probably needs to be clarity over what the landlord will do and pay for. So I'm thinking, for example, of if you've had a damp problem because of a leak and, oh, we need dehumidifiers in here, they need to run for 24 hours a day for a while. If you're struggling to pay your electricity bill, then you're going to struggle to do that. So yeah. I think there does need to be clarity about what landlords will pay for when they do the fix as well.
That's a very good point. Thanks very much for that. I'm now going to move to questions from Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. At a previous committee session on this topic, Shelter Scotland, Living Rent and Citizens Advice Scotland advised that some landlords still had the attitude of blaming their tenants for dampness and mould in their homes, and that problem was likely caused by lifestyle issues. Do you agree that this attitude still exists among some landlords, and if so, how can such attitudes be changed? And I'll pop that to Helen first, if that's OK.
OK. I would hope that that isn't the case. I think one of the other things that we have done as a regulator is work with SFHA, the Chartered Institute of Housing and Alacho to produce some advice for landlords about how to deal with issues around about mould and damp. And I think there's a very clear message in there that it's not reasonable to blame tenants for a lifestyle. I think as Rosemary I think alluded to, there's a range of reasons why properties have mould and damp. Some of it is condensation is caused by condensation, which results from normal day living. You should be able to wash your, use your shower to wash your clothes and dry your clothes in a home. So I think certainly the emphasis that we would encourage landlords to take is to listen to their tenants and to understand the root causes of the problems for dampness and mould, and to work where appropriate with tenants to help support them live in their house the best way that they can. I think that would be our expectation and our requirement of social landlords.
Unfortunately, it still is an issue, with tenants being blamed, but hopefully that attitude is getting changed, Anyone else want to come in? Rosemary, thanks.
I'm reflecting on a real-life experience of visiting a home of somebody who had mould, and it wasn't damp, it was mould. It was caused by condensation, and they'd had new double glazing fitted by their social housing landlord, and they weren't opening the windows. It was the middle of winter. It was cold. And they were drying the washing on the radiators and it was cold. So there was a lot of condensation in the air. But what that, I think, for me highlighted is those aren't problems that we should be looking to fix. I think those are issues that landlords should be encouraged to work with and support their tenants to help them understand and help support them through it. Because it can be, quite a insignificant maybe for us, but very significant if you're on a low income. Yeah, don't worry about the mould in the bathroom. You just need to clean it off with bleach every day. Well, if you're struggling to pay for food, you're not going to double your bleach bill. And I know that might sound, minor, but these things are often big impacts. If you're having to work and juggle a couple of jobs, do you have time to do all of this? So I think this comes back to the support rather than fix needs to be the attitude. And I think we're moving there.
Absolutely.
Yeah, no, I absolutely agree. I don't think we can and we shouldn't be blaming tenants. It's not a lifestyle issue. The Ombudsman England 100% right. Homes are supposed to be habitable. And I think, and I also agree with Helen, I think it's disappointing where this does occur and it shouldn't occur, but I absolutely accept that it does occur from time to time. And I think a lot of this comes from, I think as Rosemary said, that tenants and landlords should be working together. There needs to be a kind of skill set amongst landlords to be able to support tenants. It's probably too easy at times to blame a tenant because it's seen as a solution, because then that responsibility is passed to someone else. If practitioners, landlords, had more knowledge and skills in some of the more challenging issues to deal with maybe some of the structural issues that are in a home, then we wouldn't get to that point of tenant blaming. So I think the more that we can increase the knowledge and skills and deal with some of the kind of complex structural issues that are driving damp and mould in people's homes, because they're not necessarily for a kind of housing officer to come in and be able to make that assessment. It's a much more technical specialist understanding you need. But if we've got that deeper knowledge, then we will work more closely with tenants to address that, and we'll move hopefully far past the discussion of this being a lifestyle issue, because it's far from it.
Thanks for that. Move on to the next question. Are tenants significantly aware of their rights in terms of quality of housing they're entitled to and how to enforce the rights? And how can landlords work with the tenants to promote their rights and ensure complaints systems are clear and easy to use? And I'll go to the Ombudsman. Rosemary, are you OK with that?
I think probably for people who are tenants of RSLs tend to be aware, in our experience, of how to ask for repairs, maintenance, how to escalate things. And I think that probably reflects the relationship that tenants have because of things like the housing charter. Also, RSLs are required to report on complaint numbers. We've seen ourselves press coverage that there's a sharp rise in complaints about mould and damp. Now, I think I agree it's not necessarily an indicator that the problem's getting bigger, but it's maybe people are more aware. Now, whether making complaints means you're aware of your rights, I think is debatable, because as you know, a point you raised earlier, that however accessible a complaints route is, people don't necessarily, if they're in a vulnerable position, use that because they might feel disempowered. They don't want to be seen as a troublemaker. Their housing is important to them, and they don't want to put a tenancy under threat, or they've got limited time and resources, you know, holding down several jobs or other caring responsibilities. And there is sometimes an element, well, I went before and it didn't get fixed, so there's no point. But I do think that the understanding of rights is probably more related to the confidence that you have as a tenant. And it's the point that you were making, Callum, about this joint skill set and working together. I recall the Scottish Human Rights Commission worked closely with tenants in Leith. Now, this was some time ago. It was, I think, 2015 to 2019, and they saw an increased confidence in people raising issues. And I think that's probably the question, not do you know you can do it, but do you have the confidence to do that, and is there support to do that? Now, outside the RSL sector, I don't really have any data or views on that, sorry.
Thanks. Anyone else, Callum?
So we, ahead of the session, we spoke to a number of our members and 10 members to try and get a kind of sense around what tenants' priorities, and I suppose I'd bracket them into four pockets, really. So the first one was around clear and accessible information, exactly as you said. So actually clarity on kind of what their rights are and how they can enforce them, what the kind of steps they have. Ensuring third-party assurance, so the use of kind of contractors, others who aren't necessarily, don't have a vested interest, maybe a landlord or a tenant, or someone who can speak with authority around some of the causes and the solutions to the problem. Regular inspections of the home, actually ensuring that they aren't being addressed. People are coming forward with complaints, but actually as part of a proactive assessment process. And ultimately, the most important one is an adequate response. You know, also, I think tenants are reasonable. Tenants recognise sometimes the scale of problems. They aren't going to be addressed necessarily quickly, but what they want is responded to quickly and then to work in partnership with them to address that in the most reasonable time space. And that's what's more broadly, they're the four things that I think tenants, and that was, I should stress, that was from social housing tenants rather than private renting tenants, but I'd imagine the same is equally applicable.
Thank you. Anyone else? Helen?
The point I would make is that empowering tenants to hold their landlords to account is something that's very much at the heart of what we do as a regulator. Our statutory objective is to protect the interest of tenants, and we would certainly emphasise to landlords that it's really important that they listen to their tenants and take any complaints seriously. So while we don't have a role as an organisation to deal with individual complaints, we have worked closely with the SPSO to make sure that landlords make information available to their tenants about how to raise complaints when things do go wrong, which, you know, on occasion they do, and that the landlords learn from how they deal with those complaints. Tenants can also come to us with what we are called significant performance failures. So where there's a significant number of tenants have identified a failing in the part of their landlord and their landlord is not responding to that, they can approach us, and that's something that we would look at in terms of a potential systemic failure within that landlord. In terms of the numbers of applications we get for SPS, they are significant. They're fairly small numbers, but we take all of these seriously and consider each of them in their own merits.
Thanks for that.
Just to add a little bit, in terms of damp and mould issues, we've specifically started monitoring since last December in relation to damp and mould issues which come through to the regulator, and in most of those instances they've been in relation to individual complaints that have come through. So we have signposted individuals to SPSO or through their landlord. Previous to that we didn't monitor that, it was all part of the repairs element, so that we're also keeping an eye on how that is being monitored now too.
Thanks for that. Hand you back.
Okay, thanks, Marie. Now, come to questions from Annie Wells.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. This is really a specific question for Rosemary. We've spoken about complaints in the earlier part of this session, but what I was wondering is, can you give us an overview of the scale of complaints that you get about social landlord services, specifically relating to dampness and mould in the housing? And what are the key problems and outcomes in any complaints you've considered? And on top of that, given we've heard about the increased focus on dampness and mould, are you expecting to see an increase in the number of complaints? And what do you expect social landlords to be doing just now to address this situation?
Right. In terms of the scale, last year we had 618 complaints about housing. So that's registered social landlords and local authorities. Now, about 40% of those, 245, were logged as repairs or maintenance. And at that point, mould and damp would have been embedded within that. So at the we did introduce this identifier, so we started logging. We did a search, just a free text search, to look back over the cases. And we identified last year 7. 2 were logged, 7 came up in a search. Mm-hmm. But that's probably a slight underestimate. This year, we currently have, bear in mind it's still only May, we have 5 that are open. Cases that we're looking at. We've already logged for where we've given advice and referred it back to the landlord to make a complaint. So what we are not seeing and identifying is huge numbers, mm-hmm. but I think they are likely to rise because awareness is rising. Mm-hmm. Now, in terms of what I would expect the RSLs to be doing is being aware of what the issues are so the complaints don't arise in the first place. That's the ultimate aim, as my colleagues have said. But also, if they do have a complaint, because it goes to them in the first instance, mm-hmm. to fix it quickly and not to wait, not to put somebody all the way through a complaints mm-hmm. process to try and resolve it and fix it. Now, We have some examples of particular cases where, when it's come to us, mm-hmm. it has resolved it. They've fixed it, but ideally it shouldn't have come to us. So, some examples of particular cases. So, a poor state of repair over several years, broken heating, damp, mould. Complainer was decanted to another property. And then they had heating issues in their new property. Mm-hmm. So there is something about, where you move people to and what checks you do before tenants even go into a property. Now, at the point at which it was known about, they did act quickly and they sent engineers out. They fixed it, in good time, replaced the boiler. So we've also come across examples where work that was urgently needed and there was a young child in the house didn't get done as quickly as it should mm-hmm. in the first instance. I think they're getting better at responding quickly. But it's underlying some of that complaint was also the communication. Letting the tenant know what was happening when things would be fixed by. So communication, I think, is just as important as the issue. But I'd also be expecting associations to learn from their complaints, not just monitoring the issue, but monitoring mm-hmm. how they respond and what they learn from complaints to see if there were things that could have been done in a more preventative way that might apply to others. The one other observation I would make is there is, we have observed a tendency where there is an underlying issue to bring in experts mm-hmm. and to actually bring in consultants to try and identify the problem. But ideally, they should be identifying it before it becomes a problem.
Thank you very much for that. And I've got a question probably for Helen to start off with. You'd mentioned you'd wrote to all social landlords last year about considering the systems that they have in place to ensure that the homes are not affected by mould and damp. And I was just wondering, what is your view on whether the landlords have these systems in place now or how will you be checking that landlords are doing this?
Yeah, I suppose there's probably two things that I would highlight. We asked when we wrote to landlords in before Christmas and asked them to tell us if there was any problems. A small number of landlords have contacted us and told us that they could do more and they are looking at the systems and processes that they're putting in place. So we've been engaging with those landlords to get that assurance, and certainly from the information that we've had and the engagement we've had with those landlords, we've been encouraged. Mm-hmm. I think as Callum said at the beginning, the focus on issues around a bit damp and mould has certainly made landlords think quite carefully about the systems and processes that they had in place and how they're reporting on that. So I think we've certainly got a sense that landlords are taking it seriously. They might not all be quite there yet, because sometimes introducing new systems and processes take a bit of time to work through, but they're certainly encouraged by the direction of travel.
Excellent. Thank you very much for that. Yes.
Wanted to add, I think the events at Rochdale were probably, unfortunately, a wake-up call, because what they changed, I think, was awareness of the risk mm-hmm. and a more risk-based approach to tenants' needs, not just individual people's mm-hmm. needs as well, I think is what this is probably leading to. So it changed the perspective rather than changing or adding to an existing problem.
Yeah. No, thanks very much for that. And this is a question probably for Callum and Helen initially. But along with Alacho and SFHA, you produced a briefing note for social landlords on dampness. How will you be ensuring that good practice is this briefing has been implemented? So has it been implemented on a wider basis, and is there any follow-up work planned?
Yes, there is. So actually, we're almost... So that briefing was concluded, I think, published in early February for practitioners, social landlords, and since then we've actually continued to do a lot of work. We do sort of masterclasses and events. We're invited social landlords and all housing practitioners to attend kind of round tables on damp and mould. We've got a subsequent briefing that's aimed at governing board members, so particularly looking at the governance of both at local authority level and in housing associations about how they can address their concerns around assurance and ask kind of challenging questions around kind of stock quality and kind of what landlords will do. And this will continue, I think, as our job as kind of national representative organisations in the housing sector, whether CIH, SFHA, LACHO or others, to continue to kind of challenge and provide advice and support, and support is a big part of it as well. I signpost people to the right training, understand where good practice is going on, how we disseminate that. The good practice guide that you talk about has a number of kind of instances of good practice in there. Drawn one particularly from Eastern Bartonshire, where they use a kind of independent contractor that I think speaks to my earlier point around giving that kind of confidence to landlord and tenant around actually what the root cause of the problem is and addressing it. So I think for the housing sector, we recognise our responsibility to provide that kind of good practice and support. I think we will continue to do so.
Perfect. I don't know if you've got anything to add, Helen.
Probably just a couple of things. And in terms of some of the work we do with landlords, we require all social landlords to give us each year an annual assurance statement. And that sets out or confirms that the landlords are complying with our regulatory standards and requirements. As part of that, we would expect landlords to be satisfying themselves that they meet all of their tenant and resident safety obligations, including handling instances around mould and damp. So we would be expecting landlords to tell us through the annual assurance statement if they weren't complying with that. What we have also restarted doing this year is a programme of what we call annual assurance visits, where we go out and speak to a small number of landlords about the process that they've went through to complete their annual assurance statement visits and their annual assurance statements. And we've just started that programme of visits for 11 landlords this year that we're going out to speak to. And one of the things that we're looking at as part of that process is how they've satisfied themselves around tenant and resident safety. And we will publish our findings and lessons learned from that once we've concluded those visits. And that will help landlords think about how they complete their next annual assurance statements, the visits statements that they produced to us at the end of October. And we will also, as I say, get the next round of the charter returns, which will include SHQS compliance at the end of May.
Perfect. Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thanks very much, Annie. And we're now moving to questions from Willie Coffey.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning, everyone. It's pretty appalling, isn't it, that we've had to wait for the inevitable tragedy to occur to waken everybody up to this issue, isn't it? I've been a local councillor since 1992 and a member of the Parliament now since 2007, and I would say that one of the most frequently occurring complaints I had as an elected member is about dampness and mould in tenants' houses. It's greatly improved, I'll say that right now, it's greatly improved where I'm from, but it's still there. And I suppose the question I want to ask you now, do you think that it's now time that the statutory definition of what a tolerable standard is should now include mould and condensation as a recognised hazard? And I would appreciate your views on that direct question. Let me start with Rosemary, please.
I don't think I have the technical answer to it, but if I give the human answer, I wouldn't want to live in that, so why would anybody else? And I think this comes back to there needs to be a double understanding. One is structural, it's about property, it's about root causes, but the other is about people and what they have a right to life and good housing. And if it is a major problem, then it... putting it as a standard would be one way of addressing it, because it's a way of holding people accountable.
Yep. Helen, what would your views be in including it in the statutory definition?
Yeah, I mean, as Rosemary says, it's hard to look at some of the pictures that and think that that's acceptable, that people live in those conditions. I suppose the question is about... for us as a regulator, our focus is on making sure that landlords have got good information about the quality of their stock. I suppose irrespective of whether there's a specific reference to mould and damp and the tolerable standard, and that they are they've got appropriate investment plans in place, maintenance plans, they're keeping their properties in good condition. So I think for us that would be the important part. I suppose the question is if that brings an extra lever to focus that. But I think certainly in terms of our approach to quality of stock, you know, we are very much focused on making sure that the properties are warm, safe and dry and are in a reasonable condition for people to live in.
Mm-hmm. See, just in your answer to an earlier question, Helen, you reminded us that 75% of homes meet the housing quality standard, and that sounds great, but it doesn't include this issue about condensation and mould are not included there. So if they were included, that percentage of houses that meet the standard would drop considerably, wouldn't it?
Well, I mean, I think the housing quality standard talks about properties being free from serious disrepair and being warm, safe and dry. And I suppose that's my point. If there's an issue, there's a serious problem with condensation and mould and dampness. And these problems arise for a complex set of reasons and issues, it would be hard to see how landlords could report that those properties were meeting the housing quality standard, would be my view on that.
Thank you. Callum, should it be part of the formal definition now that mould and condensation should be in there as a key hazard?
I think there's a real case for it, isn't it? I think the evidence the committee's heard of the last few weeks can suggest that. I think my one concern is that we spend a lot of time looking at kind of standards and definitions without actually then getting to the cause. So I think now's at that point, how does that help tenants today, tomorrow, even over the next few years, to spend time? What we need, I think, on any issues, we need kind of, we talked earlier about tenants' rights, so what are the right mechanisms for enforcement? So how can tenants then to actually take them to enforce that? Do landlords have the funds then to address the kind of the failings in the property? And if they're not habitable at that standard, are we then able to then build new homes and replace stock outside the existing targets that we already have on building new homes? Do we have, as I said earlier, do we have enough skills and knowledge in the sector? So I think it's encouraging. I think everybody wants to see higher standards in the housing sector, irrespective of the tenure. I think that's an aspiration that everyone you hear, excuse me, will share. But I do think it has to be matched by the right levels of kind of enforcement mechanisms, the right amount of money so that we can deliver on that, and the right skills and knowledge so that practitioners can continue to meet the kind of needs tenants have. But in principle, absolutely.
I mean, don't worry, I'm going to ask the Housing Minister next when he joins us in the next session. I'm going to ask the same question. But I wonder if I could just put to you another point that we've heard recently that the UK government's thinking about proposing its own amendments to its own housing bill to require social landlords to both investigate and fix damp and mould in their properties and apply time limits to that. Is that a potential direction of travel for Scotland to look at? I mean, I'm going to ask the Housing Minister again when he comes in, but what do you think yourself, Callum?
So back to one of my earlier answers, I think there's an absolute timeliness in responding to a tenant would provide clarity. I think that's one of the kind of a complaint that tenants will have about not feeling they responded to in a timely manner. I think the complexity of an issue would find it difficult to give a time frame for addressing it. So until you've actually went and looked at the cause of it, it's difficult to assess how long a kind of remedy may take. It could take weeks, it could take months. So I think that aspect to me is difficult. I think there's more of a compelling case around a kind of timely response and actually ensuring that there's that engagement between the landlord and tenant. But a satisfactory remedy, I think, would be difficult to put a kind of an absolute time frame on that. I think so long as the tenant feels there's a satisfactory relationship there between themselves and landlord has been addressed, that's more of an outcome I think it's important to focus on.
Do you think, Callum, that landlords should be permitted to let a house that have got clear signs of mould and condensation?
I don't think that'd be appropriate. I think back to Rosemary's point earlier, as any individual, any household, actually, we wouldn't be seeking to kind of take on a kind of property with serious kind of structural deficiencies or serious failings. And I'd hope, particularly, I'd hope the landlords aren't doing that in, at scale. Certainly, the social landlords aren't looking at houses at turnover time, at void time, and then looking to kind of let them out again. That's entirely inappropriate.
Rosemary?
I was going to make that very point about not moving people into a property that has an issue in the first place. Not specifically about housing and timescales, but a general observation about putting timescales on the face of statute. Once they're on the face of statute, they become a lot more difficult to change. And if they are too long or too short, you are stuck with them for a while. And an alternative approach might be to refer to timescales that's in secondary legislation or statutory guidelines so that they can be changed if needed. One of the issues, I think, with having a fixed time point is that it sort of is allowing you that amount of time, whereas what we want to encourage is the behaviour of fixing it straight away, because the housing stock is important and there isn't enough housing and we don't want it to be stuck in this limbo of not being fixed, or, oh, it's all right, I've got a few more weeks to do that, or months. So that's just a general observation.
What would you say in the UK, potential UK government approach to this and setting timescales?
Yeah, I mean, I would say that at the moment the social housing charter indicators do provide fairly strong indicators around about how quickly landlords deal with emergency repairs or getting repairs right first time, and I think there's, you know, so there's already probably a bit of a mechanism there in a focus. I think it's about understanding how landlords are treating specific concerns around about mould and damp and getting to the root cause of the problem and fixing it appropriately. So one of the things we will be consulting on as part of our framework review, though, is what we're keen to hear from the tenants and landlords about what a measure would look like, about how quickly landlords should be dealing with them. I think we would be keen to get tenants and landlords' views about what appropriate mechanisms would be for doing that. And can I just pick up on your question about whether it is reasonable for landlords to let properties that have got problems with mould and damp, and I would say probably no, that's not the case. And again, I would point to the charter, which already sets out that landlords should be, you know, when they're allocating properties, their homes should be, I think it says, clean, tidy and in a good state of repair, meet SHQS and any other building quality standards in place. So I think I would hope that that's not happening, and if it was happening, then absolutely tenants need to be able to have a mechanism for raising concerns about that.
But the absence of mould in that criteria allows them to allocate the house legally with mould in it. I'm absolutely clear in that, my belief that that's the case. Do you think that needs to change to turn this round?
If that's happening, then I would argue that, I would agree that would probably need to change.
Just a final last point on it. Our colleagues from Live and Rent, who came the other week, a couple of weeks ago, suggested a possible compensation element could be attached to this if the problem's not resolved and whatever timescale we think is appropriate. Is that something that you might see as being workable or supported? Callum?
I think that the risk of such a mechanism is that it's taking from tenants. So ultimately, who's paying for that? It's the landlord, and the landlord's income comes from tenants. So I understand the kind of the principle behind that, and that people should be compensated. I think the mechanism actually giving that compensation is difficult. And I think that what we said earlier, actually, we've got challenges across the housing sector. We've got improvements and supply challenges and affordability concerns. And I think establishing that principle would ensure that almost tenants are paying for repairs elsewhere. I understand it's trying to create an incentive for landlords to respond more speedily, but I'm probably a little bit uncomfortable with that.
Okay, thanks. Rosemary, any view on that compensation element of it and as part of that process?
I think I'd probably echo what Callum said, but I would differentiate between compensation and reimbursement.
because reimbursement for the impact of something, you know, all your clothes go mouldy, your bedding goes mouldy, that is different, I think, to compensation. And so the two probably need to be considered separately.
Mm, thank you. Helen, Nicola?
Probably not much more to add to what other Calman was maybe already said.
OK, thanks very much for those contributions. Thanks, convener. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Willie, now we're going to move to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. Thank you for joining us this morning. At our previous evidence session, Citizens Advice Scotland told the committee that some of their social housing clients had been told that there's not enough funding to resolve their problem and that they would have to wait until the next funding cycle to see whether it could be resolved. In your experience, is this a common occurrence? And should, in your view, social landlords receive additional Scottish Government funding to help address these dampness problems? I don't know who wants to start first. Callum, did you?
Thanks, Matt. So I'm not aware of the prevalence of this state of absolute. I can defer to Citizens Advice Scotland on that, but I think the broader point around a funding challenge is absolutely true. I think the challenge that landlords are facing right now, we've got essentially three competing priorities around affordability, around new supply and around investment in new stock, and really, really challenging targets. And I think what we're finding right now is the sector is having to choose two out of three. And I think the priority has to be existing tenants, and it has to be. So that means keeping rents as affordable as possible and investing in new stock, which I think will put at risk if the government's plans for and priorities around new supply. I think that's inevitable. I think we have to be realistic around that. However, I think if we're focused on improving stock further and we're kind of identifying new problems, as we are through this inquiry and the discussion on damp and mould, then I think there absolutely could be the need for further investment so we can meet the ambition that we have for improving the stock in Scotland. I say that not because I want to draw back on new supply programmes. I don't. I think it's incredibly important, but I do think there is a balance that landlords are facing, and I don't think it's feasible for them to move at the pace which is perhaps anticipated around affordability, new supply, and retrofit.
Thanks.
Pick up just to say, in terms of the data that we collect from RSLs specifically, and that doesn't cover local authorities, we know that in 2021-22, RSLs spent £680 million on all the repairs and maintenance, and that was a 44% increase on the previous 12 months, probably not unexpected when you think about the impact of the pandemic and the restrictions that were in place. But I think what that does show is a significant investment on the part of RSLs in repairing and maintaining their stock. Having said that, you know, there are a number of pressures on landlords, and as Callum has talked about, the pressures on building new homes as well as investing in their existing stock is a really particular challenge, and certainly one in terms of the engagement that we have with landlords, keen to understand how landlords are managing their business and ultimately managing their business in a way that allows them to maintain rents at an affordable level, because I think that is very much at the heart of what tenants are trying to do.
Yeah, that's helpful. In terms of that data, are you drilling down into that further to find out, you know, that specific point which was put to us, whether or not that's, you know, it's not something I imagine is then recorded when people are told we don't have the resource for that, and so it's a waiting time issue for any repairs. It's a difficult one. Obviously, this is something Citizens Advice Scotland have said to us. I just wondered in terms of whether or not that's more common or if it's an issue in certain parts of the country, who, for councils, for example, who maybe have funding challenges, and whether or not you've captured anything that's very specific to some local councils being in this situation.
We don't get data from councils on their financial and investment plans. It's specifically around about RSLs that we have information on. We have certainly seen landlords looking at their business plans and looking at how they cast their planned investment and maintenance programmes. And you know, I touched on some of the challenges in terms of what landlords are looking to deliver in terms of new homes and investing in their existing homes. There's also the broader economic climate, the pressure that landlords are under there. They're seeing their costs increasing significantly, and we're certainly hearing anecdotally of significantly above inflation increases in some particular building costs, material costs, and pressures around labour. So we're actively working with all RSLs to encourage them to look at their business plans and look at how they manage that. But sometimes what we have seen is that to allow them to manage their business plans, they are pushing out, are having to push out their planned investment and maintenance programmes.
Yeah, thank you. And specifically in relation to private rented housing, this may be for yourself, Callum. Do you have any views about how effective the repairing standard is and the tribunal for enforcing that as a way of ensuring that quality private rented housing is also free of dampness and mould as well, or any data around that in Scotland as well?
I think that nothing from the Institute ourselves, but I certainly know there was a kind of report, Rent Better, that was published a number of years ago, looked at the experience of tenants going through the tribunal system and found it to be wanting, found it didn't necessarily address the issues and actually tended to undermine that relationship between the kind of landlord and the tenant themselves. So the pace in which going through the tribunal system, the satisfactory outcomes and ultimately the relationship with the landlord could break down. I think given the lack of rent supply in certain pockets of the country as well, I think ultimately deters a lot of tenants from taking forward issues. I think tenants feel lucky to have a property, which means they don't want to create tension. So I think there's absolutely something about how we can create a kind of process for responsiveness in the private renting sector that allows landlords to allows tenants to raise issues, but also allows landlords to address them. I think the reality is that private landlords are different. They don't have the capital and the scale of social landlords when they're looking to address some of the kind of the challenges in their stock. It's very, very different and can be difficult. So it's about how do we find the mechanisms and the money to allow private landlords, because ultimately we're looking about improving the housing condition for that tenant. So is there a need for kind of grant funding to help support some element of repairs in the private renting sector, which will ultimately lead to better housing outcomes for the tenant, which I think ultimately is the priority for everyone?
Yeah. And just on that point, again, do you think there's... I look at this as an Edinburgh MSP and see kind of the problems with the housing market at the minute here in the capital. Do you think Edinburgh's got a very specific problem with regards to quality of housing stock? I undertook a FOI myself into dampness surveys, and the council responded saying from 2019 they had 122 undertaken. Last year it was 1,215. So there's, I think, issues specifically in Edinburgh which are building up. I just wondered if you had anything from your experience you would say is Edinburgh showing a sign of really going the wrong direction in this as well?
I certainly don't know from our evidence or information that we can say there's anything unique about Edinburgh compared to any other parts of the country. I think back to kind of earlier questions around kind of prevalence is yours. I don't have kind of geographical specific information. I do think the greater attention there's been on damp and mould is undoubtedly bringing more people forward, and that's positive. I think the more we understand the prevalence of it, the more we're getting responses, the sector will be able to respond more thoughtfully.
Specifically, we have been engaging with Edinburgh, particularly in relation to damp and mould within their properties. In July last year, we contacted Edinburgh following media reports of damp and mould within their properties, in particular in two areas within Edinburgh, specifically around Muir House and Morden. So we have been having regular engagement with Edinburgh on a monthly basis around damp and mould to establish the scale of the problem with them. They have got an improvement plan in place, and we are monitoring that on a regular basis. They are making improvements, and they're putting in and recruiting additional resources to try and deal with some of the issues there. So they've also told us that they're looking to invest in retrofit and energy efficiency improvements within those two particular areas. So our engagement plan was updated to reflect that engagement, and we'll seek to review that on a regular basis with them.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
Thanks, Miles. I'm just going to stick with
that area of conversation for a bit more. So, Helen, I think at the beginning you noted that 75% of stock met the Scottish Housing Quality Standard. We understand, though, that some landlords' stock will be consistently below average, and we'd be interested to hear what action you would take around that.
As each year we carry out what we call our annual risk assessment, and one of the key pieces of intelligence that we look at is landlords' compliance with the housing quality standard. So where an organisation was showing significant levels of failure in terms of SHQS compliance, we would engage with those individual landlords. We would publish, Nicola referred to the engagement plan for Edinburgh Council, but we would publish engagement plans for those landlords, setting out the areas of risk and, that we had identified, the failures and the assurances that we would be looking for from those organisations, and we would work with them to make sure that they were able to deliver their improvements and their compliance levels. We've seen a particular issue with compliance around the EICR requirements and the linked smoke and heat detectors. They were new requirements that were introduced a couple of years ago for landlords, and we've seen some landlords have difficulties in meeting the compliance levels with that, but we've engaged with those landlords and seeking assurance about the plans that they've got in place to deliver that. I think this year, when we publish the outcomes from our annual risk assessment, there are, I think, 9 organisations that we're dealing with, RSLs that we're dealing with in terms of tenant and safety issues, and 5 where we're seeking further assurance around stock quality as well.
Okay, thanks for that. Now going to move on to questions from Ivan McKee.
Thank you, Convener. I just draw the committee's attention to my register of interest with regard to rental properties. I've got a few questions to cover off. The first one was round about the cost of living situation and how that's impacting, and this has already been mentioned, I think Rosemary kind of mentioned it earlier on, but clearly if tenants are expected to deal with some of those dampness and mould problems with regards to using heating more, etc., are you seeing the cost of living crisis having a direct impact on those challenges? Who wants to go first, Helen?
I suppose the simple answer is yes. The cost of living crisis is absolutely having an impact, and particularly the feedback that we get is that issues around energy costs are particularly challenging, and that obviously if people are struggling to pay their energy bills will increase the risk of them not turning on their heating and compounding problems around mould and damp. We had specifically done a piece of work with what we call our national panel of tenants and service users, and that's a panel of just under 500 tenants and other service users, and we work with them to do some research each year to ask a range of questions. We published the most recent research on that in August last year, and I think that highlighted then the extent of the financial difficulties that tenants were experiencing. So I think some, a quarter of the people that responded said that they weren't currently managing well financially. 6 out of 10 said their financial circumstances were worse than they had been before the pandemic, and 7 out of 10 were concerned about the future affordability of their rent, and half experienced difficulty heating their homes. What we have done is this year re-looked at those questions again, and we also added some specific questions around about home safety, including mould and damp, and linked to that issues, Eric asked some questions about tenants' experience of heating their homes. We literally have just received the first report, the first draft of those findings, and we intend to finalise and publish the report over the summer. We can share that report with you, but I, from the very preliminary look at that, I think the kind of findings that we've seen last year are only getting worse this year.
OK, thanks. Anyone else? Rosemary?
We don't have the same sort of data, but certainly through applications for review of Scottish Welfare Fund, what we are seeing is themes, and the theme related to cost of living. It's not just damp and mould, it's financial resilience. Where there is a one-off event, like there is a leak in the property or you burst pipe or something, is the resilience to be able to cope with that, where people might have at one point the cost of living pressures now mean there is there is no way to react and put something right if it does go wrong in that way. The other area that we've also picked up through some of that work is things like redecorating. The funding for this appears to be quite low, so if there was a one-off event, you don't have the financial resilience. Sometimes tenants have to live with the impact of this for quite a long time, and I would say that's where the cost of living is probably having a significant impact.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thanks. Second point I was going to ask was about the potential for a new common housing standard and your views on whether that could help to improve the quality of rental houses in relation to dampness and mould. Callum.
So I think irrespective of the tenure that anyone lives in, whether or private rent aid, social rent aid or owner occupier, I think there's a case for a common housing standard. I think that we have a certain expectation of the way kind of housing, the quality should be, and I think that's quite aspirational, but I think that's something that we should look to developing. I don't think that in the short term, though, will address some of the issues that we have here, which I've kind of mentioned already in my evidence. I think we need to look at actually kind of the skills that are in the sector. If we're looking at a common housing standard, we need to be honest about the kind of enforcement mechanisms. And that may be a role for the new private rented sector regulator when that's developed. But also it's about the funding to address the kind of what we are seeing as kind of deficiencies in the standard, and having knowledge amongst the kind of the practitioners to address it, and the tenants to be aware of their rights. I think that's fundamental. So really, I think it's a really exciting debate looking at a common housing quality standard, something that's ambitious. I would say no matter what it would be, the floor of it would have to be the Scottish housing quality standard. We cannot go below the highest level we've got. It wouldn't make any sense. So we'd have to start there. But we know that would take a serious amount of investment. I think that's a good debate to have, but we have to be honest about how we're going to deliver on that.
OK. Anyone else? OK.
Would see is that from our perspective, our current our role is in relation to social housing, and any changes to the quality standard, I think we would as a minimum expect it to reflect the current housing quality standard.
Okay, that's fine, thanks. Next area I was going to ask a question on was round about retrofit, net zero retrofit, and the programmes that are getting rolled out there, and whether you think there's clarity on the technical standards and on how we ensure contractors are up to scratch to be able to deliver that without negatively impacting on dampness and mould challenges, taking into account, of course, need for ventilation versus insulation and so on and so forth. Is anyone any thoughts on that area?
I mean, I can go first and try and answer. I think my first answer is that there's a massive... There's an awful lot there to unpack in terms of the question. I think in terms of social landlords and the work that they are doing to meet the zero carbon agenda, I think it's probably fair to say that it's at very early stages. In terms of the financial information that we get from landlords, we are certainly encouraging landlords to start to consider how to factor in the funding to deliver that. But I think there are still some significant questions around about how they achieve that. Scottish Government has obviously taken forward work to review the energy efficiency standard, and I understand that work has been progressed. So there's not quite that clarity around what landlords are actually being asked to deliver at this point. So it's quite difficult for landlords to have firm plans in place at this point in time. And I think there's a lot of learning to be done in terms of some of the technical solutions that are being considered, and to understand what that means and what that means in terms of the tenant experience. Some of the things that we've heard back from landlords who have tested some of the stuff, which is perhaps seen as more innovative, is that there's a journey for tenants and landlords about how you live in those properties moving forward in a way that is suits the needs of tenants and is affordable for tenants. I think there's some real challenges there.
Okay, thanks. Carl?
Well, the only thing I'd add to that, I agree with everything Helen has said, but you know, this is an incredibly emerging and new sector for everyone involved, for tenants, for landlords, for the technical sector itself. And I think we need to have a little bit of humility in understanding, you know, different solutions for different types of housing and different geographical areas, depending on the conditions. And I don't, we don't have that knowledge yet. And I don't think it's taking this at a pace where we can understand what are the right heating solutions for that household in that locality that helps address the kind of their heating needs in a kind of an affordable way that address their net zero. It's very complicated. I don't think it's anyone has the answers to that. And that's, we just have to kind of approach this is slowly, but recognising the climate emergency at a pace we can afford. But it's just, we'll learn lessons as we're applying different heating technologies to different archetypes of house, hopefully learn lessons that can then roll that to scale. But we have to be humble enough to recognise it's not like a gas central heating system, it's not one size fits all.
Okay, thank you. The last point I was going to ask about was in relation to the strategic role of councils with regards to being proactive about the stock in their area, private obviously as well as social, and the resourcing they have in place to be able to address those challenges. I don't know if there's any comments on that. I think maybe Callum, if you get any comments on that.
We've talked already around the kind of the money available in the sector, and I think we can make the kind of point well recognised that, you know, there's not a lot of kind of enforcement around kind of the private renting sector that comes from local authorities just because of the kind of the revenue considerations, and I think that creates a real challenge for trying to enforce standards in the private renting sector. I think in the social sector is different. The role of the regulator absolutely provides that kind of the oversight and that support actually for the sector to improve standards, but I think the budgetary concerns, I think previous witness John Kerr spoke about this before, I think ultimately because you've got the kind of general fund that will come from general taxpayers to focus on the private housing sector, I think that makes it's hard choices for local authorities about where will they invest in enforcement in the housing sector, private housing sector, or invest in social care or something else. That's okay. A hard choice.
Good. Great. Thanks very much. Thank you.
Staying with that enforcement piece, Callum, I'm kind of interested, if there was the funding, if there was a resource available to do enforcement, what would it look like? What would we be seeing happening?
Well, I think back to maybe some of the principles we've talked about earlier, it would be, you know, working with landlords, working with letting agencies, with kind of around visits, it would be kind of responding, helping kind of direct tenants to kind of the tribunal system. I think there's a lot more about actually... The principal should be trying to work with landlords and letting agents though, to address that problem, and actually having that capacity in the private in a housing team who can draw on perhaps some of the kind of better guidance that exists across the social sector to find some of the remedies, I think would be incredibly effective. And again, this may be a role for the future private renting sector regulator.
Thanks for that. The other thing that you brought up was skills and workforce, and I think that came up last week as well, 2 weeks ago. As well, and I think what do we need to be doing in that area? Do we have people that have the sufficient expertise to be really handling the mould, damp and mould issues?
I think it's patchy. I don't think it's not comprehensive. I think that's why landlords sometimes will use contractors, because they don't have that in-house expertise. I don't think it is as comprehensive across the entire sector, and certainly not the private renting sector as well. We need to make that more available. We need to make that more accessible. We need to make it more affordable for associations and local authorities and others to draw on that insight, and then ensures part of their continuous improvement and training development programmes for their own staff. that we're having investment in training for not just the customer service facing side, but actually that technical expertise. I think there's a huge amount more we could do about ensuring the kind of there's ongoing development and knowledge in that area. It's the same for many aspects of housing. We can't damp and mould. We can't just look at an isolation. Talk about technical retrofit of homes. Look at any other issues, but I absolutely think landlords that are demonstrably investing in the skills and training of their staff, investing in customer service, are less likely to be dealing with problems later down the line.
Do you think that in Scotland we've got the kind of the resource and the innovation around looking at things? I mean, is there innovation that could be happening here? Do we have that? Do landlords have a place to go where they could get a greater understanding of what they could be doing?
I think there's a number of places that you know, my own organisation will provide that kind of support and training and qualifications through the SFHA, ALACHO, the kind of the regulator will kind of undoubtedly signpost people to kind of the right training as well. I think that ecosystem does exist, but back to perhaps that point I made earlier around what tenants looking for, all the right information in one place. There's something around that for landlords as well. Where can we go to access training? Where can we go to provide to access funding to pay for training? Where can we go to provide kind of greater advice? I think providing, you know, as part of the briefing paper that we worked with the regulator, ALACHO and SFHA, was trying to pull some of, a lot of that together in one place for the social housing sector to give them that support. There's undoubtedly more we can and should be looking to add to that over time, but that was, I think, from our perspective, a start.
Great, thanks for that. Does anyone... that was a spontaneous question because of Callum saying some things early on, but if anyone wants to come in on any of that, you're welcome to. Don't have to, though.
I don't have to.
Okay, great. Well, thank you so much. I think it's been really helpful to hear from all of you today with your evidence and your expertise and what your perspective on the issue. And I now suspend briefly to allow a changeover of witnesses. We're now joined by our second panel and by with Paul McLellan, who's the Minister for Housing from the Scottish Government. And Mr. McLellan is joined today by Scottish Government officials, Naeem Bhatti, who's the head of Fuel Poverty and Housing Standards Unit, and Darren Knox, who is the Fuel Poverty and Housing from the Fuel Poverty and Housing Conditions Analysis Team. And I welcome the witnesses to the meeting, and I now invite Mr. McLellan to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and it's good to be back. It's weird sitting at this side of the table. This time I've been a member of the committee. So good morning and thank you for inviting me to speak about this important topic. I'm grateful to all those who have contributed to the discussion thus far. I watched most of the session this morning. The tragic death of Ewa Bishak in Rochdale in 2020 has highlighted the issue of damp and mould in housing. No one should lose their life as a result of their home not being fit for purpose. It is right that we consider what further actions we can take together here in Scotland to ensure this never happens again. The quality of housing has improved over a number of years due to the action of this government. The Scottish Housing Condition Survey shows that disrepair to critical elements of the home reduced by 9 percentage points between 2012 and 2019. It also found out that over 90% of homes have no damp or condensation. The introduction of the Scottish Housing Quality Standard and Social Housing in 2012 and strengthening of repairing standard for the private rental sector shows our commitment to making improvements. However, we recognise there is much to do to make sure we continue to eradicate the remaining poor quality housing in Scotland. I know we'll be talking about the scale of these issues later. We heard witnesses at the committee on 2 May talk about the impact of living with damp and mould, that it can negatively affect all parts of people's lives, including physical and mental health, social connections, employment and education. We must keep this in mind as we move forward. The Scottish Government takes the safety of tenants very seriously and is committed to tackling disrepair in housing and ensuring good maintenance is given a high priority. Everyone should have a warm, safe and affordable home. Access to good quality housing is the focus of our Housing 2040 strategy and is a vital part of our drive to secure economic growth, promote social justice, strengthen communities and tackle inequality. I was therefore delighted to hear from National Land representatives at the previous session talking about how seriously they take this issue of damp and mould in housing. This has been exemplified by the excellent guidance that was produced by the social sector in February of this year, which makes clear that responding to damp and mould, primarily or initially as a lifestyle problem, is inappropriate and ineffective. The strategy guidance for the private sector on the updated repairing standard issued by the Scottish Government in March of this year sets out private landlords' responsibilities on dealing with damp and mould. The Scottish Government will continue to work with stakeholders to strengthen the guidance that is available for landlords and to ensure that tenants are able to escalate their concerns to first-tier tribunal for housing where needed. As Housing Minister, I am determined to ensure we continue to make progress in improving Scotland's housing, including eradicating the serious issue of damp and mould. Thank you again for inviting me along today and I look forward to your questions.
Thanks very much for that opening statement. I'd be interested to hear at national level if the Scottish Government has a good understanding. You mentioned in your statement of the scale of the problem of dampness mould in Scotland's housing. We've been hearing from the evidence in previous sessions that and earlier this morning that there really isn't enough data collection. And I just wonder if there's any improvements in data collection that the government could be making.
We do have a good understanding, Convener, at the moment. Obviously, the Scottish Housing Condition Survey is that main element just now, and that was up to 2019. And I think we heard this morning from witnesses that the next one is due in January 2024. Obviously, COVID impacted on the last number of years in terms of getting proper surveys done. I know there was external surveys that were carried out. The new one is due out in January 2024. And I think some of the evidence we took this morning, for example, from CIH and obviously with the regulator here and the SPSO, I think there's a real collaborative approach needed in terms of this. I know the SHR mentioned it, CIH mentioned it around about more work that they're doing to try and gather information. I think there's an element as well that the local authorities seem to be doing that in that regard as well. And I think one of the things I took from the evidence session again this morning was in terms of there's more an understanding of the reporting, I suppose, systems and more of an understanding about where residents need to go and tenants need to go in regard to that. So I think, you know, we've probably seen an increase in some of the figures that came through. I think it was mentioned this morning. But I think it's good that now the tenants have a greater understanding of that. I think the new survey that comes through in January 2024, which is obviously just about 6 or 7 months away, will give us a greater understanding in terms of that.
Thanks for that. Yes, certainly I think events of the last year have been quite a wake-up call for everybody, and it's, I think, maybe also given a sense to tenants that this is something that they can raise. Shelter Scotland told the committee that there are structural issues that are important to addressing problems of dampness, in particular not enough new social homes are being offered, and that funding needs to be available for building social homes and upgrading current homes without one impacting the other. Do you agree that the structural issue of supply is a fundamental problem that might help tackle dampness and mould? And on top of that, do social landlords need any further funding support to help them deal with specific problems of dampness and mould in their homes?
I think there's a number of issues. I think it was, again, CIH. I mentioned Callum from CIH talked around about probably the issues that are facing social landlords at the moment. And I think you mentioned about three elements. One was obviously looking at the retrofitting agenda. One was looking at existing repairs. And obviously the most important element is looking through the affordable housing supply programme. For me, I think one of the key things, and I've already met Edinburgh and Glasgow, in terms of that, I'm planning to meet as many local authorities as I can in the next number of months. It's trying to understand their own individual circumstances. I think that's important. And I think that obviously the affordable housing supply programme is an important part of delivering that, because obviously they have to apply to new regulation, to the standards, to make sure there is no damp or mould in terms of that. So, as we know, there is a struggle in terms of trying to how we match the issues around about construction inflation, which is around about 20%, and obviously interest rates as well are causing an issue around about that. So, yeah, we have to increase what we're doing around about the affordable housing supply programme. That there's no doubt. But it's, for me, it's trying to get a greater understanding of all the local authorities, and certainly the meetings I've had with Edinburgh and Glasgow in the last week or so have given me a greater understanding of that. So I think that's really important in that regard. I think in terms of looking at other schemes that are available, I think, you know, we're obviously talking around about there's other funds available. Net Zero Heat Fund, I think, is there to try and look at how local authorities can use that as well. And again, it's trying to get the understanding of local authorities exactly where they kind of sit in that. So affordable housing supply programme is incredibly important, but I think there's a greater understanding of where each local authority kind of sits and how we can try and measure the impact about what they're trying to do in their own individual circumstances.
Okay, thanks for that. Yes, I think I can imagine in your new role, it's just kind of trying to, as you say, get the understanding of what's really going on and take that nuanced approach. The committee's heard that the cost of living crisis can cause or exacerbate dampness problems, as tenants can't always afford to put their heat on. And SFHA welcomed the Fuel Insecurity Fund, but suggested it could be moved onto a long-term basis to help social landlords plan. What more can the Scottish Government do to help tenants with the cost of living crisis and their energy costs?
I think that's a good point that was made by the SFHA, and I think the reason, obviously, that was picked up by the First Minister, who, you know, tripled the fund to £30 million, I think, trying to understand there is an issue out there in that regard. And I think that's the broader, you know, we're obviously talking about heating costs, but there's also food costs are going up as well in terms of that. So that has that broader impact. Now, we will be undertaking an evaluation of the effectiveness of the Fuel Insecurity Fund in terms of that. I think one of the key things as well is I've also got responsibility for debt and welfare advice. So I've had initial meetings with agencies around about that. So it's trying to ensure, in terms of capacity they have to deal with this issue, I think that's an incredibly important thing I've already raised with them at that stage, to make sure that the advice is coming through, and as well as the Fuel Insecurity Fund that's there. But we will be taking an evaluation of the scheme later on this year. It is having an impact, you know, positive impact, I think, so far in terms of that. But I think it's not going to go away this year. It's going to be an issue. I think it will continue for a number of years. So we need to support the sector in dealing with that. The Fuel Insecurity Fund, I think, as I said, manages to do that. And I talked before about the Net Zero Energy Fund. And again, it's trying to understand where, you know, how can we accelerate that programme, if you like, because the more houses we can get through that are net zero and obviously more energy efficient, you know, the better the housing stock becomes in each of these areas and across Scotland.
Absolutely the case, that need for acceleration to improve our housing stock. I'm now going to move to questions from Annie Wells.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Some witnesses in the previous session said that it was difficult for tenants to enforce their rights to live in good quality homes free from dampness. And we've also heard that it can be particularly difficult for private tenants to enforce their rights, and that the tribunal process is not as accessible as it could be. I was just wondering if you would agree with that, Minister, and if so, how can the Scottish Government help to improve this situation?
I think there's a number of points to be raised. Again, I think it depends on where you are in the country. I think that's an important aspect, and I think that's why it's important for me to get round as many of the local authorities. And I said I had a chat with Glasgow just last week, and can you raise this issue as well as Edinburgh? But it's important to go to authorities, for example, in the Highlands, who might have a completely different context in terms of where they are. I think one of the key things, obviously, that might not be known under, you know, and I suppose it's getting the message out there, is obviously local authorities can make that representation under third party as well. So I think it's trying to understand about local authorities, how they interact, I suppose, with the tenants and residents around about that. I think one of the other key things that I talked about as well was in terms of the organisations that are out there that can support these, and there are key ones. You may know, Annie, I mean, I was a councillor for 15 years and interacted with Shelter on some of these issues going back a number of times, and I think the help they gave, as well as the CEB and I think the other organisation as well as the Scots Association Law Centres, I think they were very helpful in terms of that. I think it comes back maybe to the point that Callum made from CIH, is I suppose there's more of an understanding around about the issue. Mm-hmm. I think one of the key challenges for both Scottish Government through debt and welfare agencies and also local authorities is to make sure that information is out there for tenants in terms of that. So I think that's one of the key things. I think the Housing and Property Chamber, I think it was brought forward, is probably less adversarial in terms of where it's there. I think even to say to somebody, you know, you're going to first-tier tribunal, would probably put off, and it did in my circuit, examples previously, it did put off people in that regard. So for me, it's trying to ensure that there's that support mechanism for tenants, because as soon as you see a tribunal, people, I think, automatically just back off. So it's working with the debt and welfare agencies, it's working with the local authorities themselves to make sure that they're getting that message out in that regard. But I think that's incredibly important because, as I said, I know people who backed off in the 15 years I had as a councillor, and examples around about that. So we are trying, as I said, to work at that, and that's part of the reason I'm trying to ground as many local authorities as possible, is trying to understand where they sit and what we can do, particularly in their own regard. One size fits all, you know, it isn't going to suit everybody. So we need to understand how we support the smaller local authorities and more remote authorities, as well as your big Edinburgh, Glasgow, Dundee, Aberdeens and so on.
Thanks very much. Thanks, Convener.
Annie,
thank you.
Going to now move to questions from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good to see you on that side of the table. So you're very welcome. Paul, you and I were local councillors for many years, and one of the big issues that recurred year after year was dampness and mould within the various housing stocks. Could I just go straight to what I think is an important question to ask you? Do you think it's now time that the government included mould and condensation as recognised hazards as part of the statutory definition of what a tolerable standard is?
Yeah, thanks, Mr Coffey. I knew this question was coming because I watched the session this morning and seeing you say you were going to ask this later on. I think it was quite important when we seen some of the feedback that Kenny came through, and I suppose when you look at damp and mould, there can be some other, there's complex issues around about that, and I think there's guidance that's already out there in terms of that. Now, there was, I think, the briefing, I think it was a reference this morning, it went out on the 1st of March, and continues that. I think it's something, I think it merits further discussion, and I think we kind of heard that this morning from the witnesses that were there. So, you know, I've got a meeting with CIH coming up, I've got a meeting with the regulator coming up also in terms of that. So it's something, you know, I'll probably discuss them at the moment. I think the tolerable standard does kind of set out in terms of where the housing should be. You know, it should be free from damp, it should be free from mould as part of that. Now, if we need specific, I suppose, definitions, I think that can be quite complex, and I said at the moment. Naeem, I don't know if you've got anything to add in terms of that, but I think there are satisfactory guidance out there at the moment. It's something, as I said, I know the witnesses said this morning, I suppose they were tentative, I suppose, in their answers around about that. But Naeem, I don't know if you've got anything to add in that regard.
Yeah, thank you for that. I think, as the Minister says, the tolerable standard, which covers all homes, includes those in the rented sector. It requires homes to be substantially free from rising or penetrating damp and have satisfactory provisions for ventilation, heating and thermal insulation. So even though the condensation damp is not specifically mentioned, the underlying causes or what causes that are adequately covered within the tolerable standard in SHQS, and the updated repairing standard also requires private landlords to have consideration of that. So, but as the Minister says, that's something, you know, which we can consider further.
I mean, really, the consequence of this at the moment is that it's entirely possible, legitimate, legal and otherwise, for a landlord to allocate a house to a family that's got mould in it. And that could happen today, it can happen tomorrow. Isn't that something we seriously want to have a look at and either clarify and embrace that as part of what a tolerable standard should be?
I heard you ask that question this morning, obviously saying, should we let out properties in that condition? And I think obviously the answer should be around a bit no. I think one of the issues that I've taken away from that is legally where do we sit in that regard, and I can come back to the committee in that, because I think we've heard the moral aspect of that, should we let it out? No. And again, that's something, you know, I want to take away and check out in the legality of in that regard and where we sit and the powers we have in that regard. Again, I don't know if Naeem's anything to add on that, but it's certainly a takeaway I had this morning and something I can come back to the committee about in that regard. But Naeem, I don't know if there's anything you want to add on that one.
Yeah, I'll just kind of pick up on the points which was kind of made by the regulator this morning around, you know, what the social charter requires for homes, for landlords, before they kind of rent them out. They have to be clean, tidy and free from serious disrepair. So, you know, landlords should not be letting out homes which are in a serious state of disrepair or any kind of disrepair. They have to kind of fix that before they do that. But as the Minister said, and I think as the regulator said as well, I mean, if there are cases, then, you know, we will need to look into that and see what more can we do to do that. And I think it's worth kind of pointing towards the guidance which has been issued by SHR and others around, you know, making it clear around we need to kind of look at damp and mould for social housing practitioners' guidance and make sure that and also the repairing standard guidance makes it clear that, you know, homes should be fit for human habitation. And as the Minister said, you know, we will look into that further. You know, what more do we need to do to make it work? But I think, as the Minister said and others have rightly recognised, you know, landlords should not be renting out homes which are not fit for human habitation.
Thank you. Could I just move on to our colleagues down south? The UK government's currently proposing to amend its own housing bill, Paul, that will require social landlords to investigate and fix damp and mould in their properties, and they're thinking about specifying time limits to achieve that. Could I ask for your comments on whether that's a potential direction of travel that we might embrace in Scotland?
Yeah, I mean, I think social landlords have to set out repair timelines in their repairs policy at the moment, so it's either emergency, urgent or routine. Now, you would think, obviously, talking about damp and mould, you would think, you know, serious cases would be, you know, classed as emergency or certainly urgent around about that. Tenants in the social sector already have a right to repair scheme, and there can be, obviously, repairs carried out in that regard. Now, as part of that, they can pay compensation. And mentioned, seen the point this morning, obviously mentioned by the SPSO, talking about compensation and reimbursement. And again, I think that's a key difference in terms of that, you know, because obviously if there's damp and mould in a house, it can impact on carpets, can impact on wallpaper and curtains and so on. So I think that's an issue that's certainly need to be picked up in that regard. And again, I watched the debate this morning talking around about setting timelines. I think it was talking around about, you know, timely response. And again, I'll probably investigate that further when I have the meeting with the regulator and the CIH in terms of that, because I think it probably needs, you know, a little bit more investigation into that. But I think, you know, setting out timelines, I think it was highlighted by the CIH this morning, you know, I think could kind of hold things back in that regard. So I think a timely response, but I think there needs to be further discussion around about that. And I think, you know, CIH made that point today, but it's certainly something I'll be discussing in that regard. I think one of the key things already is that the sector is already trying to set out its own guidance, and it did so in February. So I think it's trying to get ahead of the game in terms of Scotland, where that kind of sits. And again, one of the key things, I think, for me, when I meet the regulator and CIH over the next months and so on, and other local authorities, is to try and understand about that, where they sit. And I think one of the key things is building up that relationship as a housing minister in terms of that, and to see where that kind of goes. But I think we're kind of ahead of the game when it comes to that already. And I think, obviously, the regulator this morning mentioned around it as well about they're reviewing their guidelines and looking at that. So I'd imagine that would be part of the discussions I have with them when it comes up later on this year.
Thanks very much for that. Just lastly from me, Paul, are you therefore open to reviewing what the Social Housing Charter might look like in the broader context of these discussions?
I think in terms of that, I mean, I thought the charter was just reviewed in last November, and I know that was kind of picked up at that particular time. I think part of that discussion at the time was the stakeholder feedback we got. It was going relatively well. I think the more prevalence we see of reports and so on coming forward, and I think that's an encouraging thing, because I think, you know, more people report it, you know, we're more aware of the prevalence of damp and mould. I think that's an ongoing process, and I think the charter would obviously be reviewed on an ongoing basis. Certainly, the feedback we got from the consultation previously, that it was going quite well in terms of that. So, and again, I think it comes back to, you know, it's about meeting the Scottish Housing Quality Standard, and that should be in place. So I think that provides kind of flexibility as well within the charter. But I think the charter will be reviewed on an ongoing basis in terms of that. But certainly the feedback we got from stakeholders was that it was going relatively well at that time. Now, that was just in November last year, so you're probably talking 6 to 9 months ago. So it's still relatively new feedback we got on that issue. But again, you know, the charter will be reviewed on a regular basis.
Just finally, because of what you mentioned there, the authorities have to record that a tenant has made a complaint about mould and dampness and condensation. Is that a formal requirement to record that? Because that would seem to me that if you capture that kind of information, that would influence what the charter might look like as we move forward. So is that a formal part of what they have to gather about the condition?
I'll ask Naeem to come back on that one. I think they do, but I'll ask Naeem to come back on that one. And obviously, I mean, the charter, just coming back to the point about the charter, it's reviewed every 5 years, but obviously there's ongoing discussions, and really you look at that, you know, on an ongoing basis. But I'll ask Naeem to come back on that, on the reporting issue.
I think, as the Minister said, I mean, the Charter kind of sets out, it sets out the overall outcomes which the landlord should be achieving. It does not replace any of the legal duties the landlords have. I think, as the committee heard from earlier panel this morning, especially the regulator, that, you know, landlords have to report, you know, their repairs to, and, you know, how well they're kind of complying. And I think, as the landlord, as the regulator said earlier on this morning, they're looking at, you know, how to kind of drill down into the various bits around, you know, what are those elements of the repairs which are being done. So, I mean, it is a regulatory matter. And I think that's what the regulator is kind of looking at, that how else can we enhance the reporting around that.
Sorry to just harp on about it, but it's really important, I feel, for people that have suffered this, Paul, over the years. So the Housing Condition Survey says that there's 192,000 homes in Scotland with condensation, and I would argue that many of them have suffered from mould. But the point is, we don't know, because we don't collect that information. So how many of those houses, those 192,000 houses in Scotland that have condensation, have got mould present as well? And we don't know that, and I'm just asking, is that not something we would like to begin to gather as well?
Yeah, I mean, I think obviously the Housing Condition Survey kind of looks at that, talks about condensation, it talks about mould, and obviously, I mean, I think the key thing to mention, first of all, is that the prevalence of that is coming down. You know, I think on condensation, it's from 11% in 2011 to 8% in 2019. And I think that's, you know, you're talking around about, that's quite a difference in that regard. Mould, obviously, is the same. I think mould dropped from 12% to 9% in that regard. So I think, you know, that was from 290 to 230,000. Now, it did mention about 95% of these cases, was found to affect less than 2%. Now, again, that's from the survey. I think one of the key things we talked about this morning again was talking around about, I suppose, the duty of local authorities to go out and try and do that themselves. Again, there's more authorities for them to go out and do that. And I think, I can't recall who said it this morning, but Outreach was trying to do tenant surveys to try and find out more around about that. And I know we'll come on to how we resource that later on, and probably in some of the questions. But in terms of that, I think one of the issues for me is obviously we're working collaboratively, and that's through the CIH, that's working with local authorities and Scottish Government in terms of how we try and establish exactly what the cause of the problem is, and how, I suppose, to the extent of what the problem is as well, in terms of if 95% or less than 2%. Now, I'm not saying that's not an issue, but we have to focus on the most urgent cases first and foremost. I think it's an element of doing that. Hopefully the updated survey will give us a more accurate figure, because obviously I mentioned before, COVID before didn't allow us to go into people's properties and condition that. So 2024, which has been the result, was carried out during 2022. So once we get that, hopefully that'll give us a more accurate reflection of where that kind of sits, rather than going back to where we were a couple of years ago when it was just external investigations that were taking place.
Okay. Thank you very much for all those answers. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Willie. We'll now move on to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials. It's a further question which I wanted to ask with regard to the powers, and you've touched upon meetings you plan to have with the Scottish Housing Regulator, but my question is specifically, do you think that they have the powers currently to deal with landlords who are letting out poor quality homes with damp and mould issues, or is that something you're going to look at?
I think, you know, obviously, the regulator, you know, it sits there on its own in regards to that, doesn't report to myself, for example, and I think that's one key point. I think you heard the regulator this morning talk around about indicators, around about damp and mould. I think at the moment they do have the necessary powers, but again, I think in terms of what they're looking to do and review that, and I think it was April 24 they said they would be bringing that out. So again, I'd be really keen. I have a meeting coming up with them relatively shortly, and I would imagine I would, you know, would ask for a report around about when the indicator comes out around about 2024 as well. And obviously anything that they bring forward, I think, would be worth a meeting at that stage. I think one of the key things that they mentioned was about consulting stakeholders, and I think that's incredibly important. If it has to take another month or two for them to review that, I think it's really important that they review stakeholders. And noticed this morning, obviously, you were talking about Edinburgh as well, so that is including. I think it's important that they speak to the stakeholders, it's local authorities, but it's trying to look at the mix of local authorities. It's not your Edinburghs and your Glasgows. I mentioned before, and Tanny Bells are in about, you know, it's seen in the more remote local authorities, and how does that kind of... So I think, in terms of that, it's not the one-size-fits-all, again, when it comes to that, and I think the regulator would obviously pick that up. But, you know, I'd imagine I would be meeting with the regulator as soon, you know, soon after that report is published in that particular regard. But obviously that's something for the regulator to take forward, but I'll certainly be meeting with them as soon as that comes forward.
Yeah, that's helpful. And I know since... you were appointed to this role. I've been on at you about the Edinburgh situation quite extensively, and wondered if you believe there's specific council areas or specific housing associations where damp and mould is more of a prevalence, and the maintenance aspect of this, or just the inspection regime. And I'm not sure we've really got underneath a Scotland-wide figure to whether or not there's some outliers. And I personally, as an Edinburgh MSP, think post pandemic my mailbag around this is far greater, and given the property market in Edinburgh, people are maybe going into houses they shouldn't be as well. So I just wondered whether or not you and your officials have done any work on where this is maybe a real problem.
I certainly think in terms of the last housing condition survey that Nick Kenny came through, there was figures for each local authorities, and I'll bring Darren in a wee second in terms of that. Edinburgh didn't come up highly in that at the moment. That's not to say it's an issue just now, because I think the last survey we talked about was 2019. I think I'd say I was trying to get in as many local authorities as possible, and you and I have already met to discuss housing issues in Edinburgh. It's an issue that I'm going to be meeting in Edinburgh every 4 to 6 weeks to talk about the broader issues they have. This will be part of the discussions that we have, and I think we mentioned this morning, there was discussions this morning around about the engagement through the regulator with Edinburgh. So again, that would be an issue I would imagine I'll pick up with the regulator in that regard. But I'll ask Darren to bring in if there's anything he wants to come through in terms of that. But in terms of Edinburgh, I know you and I will be meeting on a regular basis in terms of that. I will be discussing with Edinburgh in that regard as well. So more than happy to keep up the discussion with you in that regard, including damp and mould, but also on other issues, as you know. But I'll ask Darren to come in, and if there's anything he wants to mention in regard to that.
Yeah, I mean, as the Minister says, we do monitor levels of damp, condensation and mould through the House Conditions Survey. We provide local authority level estimates based on a 3-year average. So the latest data is for the period 2017 to 19. There's nothing in that data to suggest that Edinburgh was any higher than the national average, but there were some local authorities in respect to mould that were higher than the national average. East Lothian, Dundee, Aberdeen, East Renfrewshire, Angus, Perth and Kinross and Glasgow City. But yeah, as the Minister said, I think a key thing as well is obviously this data relates to the period 2017-19. The House Condition Survey was impacted by the COVID pandemic, and the 2020 survey was unable to be completed. The 2021 survey was undertaken using a different approach to previous years, which meant that surveyors weren't able to enter properties, so weren't able to record presence of damp, mould and condensation, but we have returned to the usual approach for the House Condition Survey in April 2022. The field work's been completed and we'll be publishing the key findings in January 2024. And I think one of the things that I would probably acknowledge is that we maybe haven't reported sufficient detail on damp, mould and condensation in the past, and I think given the clear user interest, that's something we'll be looking to publish more information on.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for that. Thanks, Maureen.
Thanks, Miles.
And I'm now going to bring in Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and your officials. Minister, the committee heard that there's some good practice around preventing and tackling dampness and mould, but this needs to be more widespread and shared amongst the private landlords. How can the Scottish Government help to facilitate the sharing of good practice?
I think that's a really important point, because I think we talked about one of the key things coming through in terms of the prevalence. I suppose talking around about private rented sector, social rented is against owner-occupier. I mean, private rented, for example, was 12%, social rented was 12%. So we talked about what we're doing in the social sector. I think it's really important in terms of how we engage with the private sector in terms of that as well. I mean, I think there was a new Scottish Government issued a new repairing standard in March this year, and obviously that was shared and mentioned and gave statutory guidance for private landlords, which I think was talking about the issues of damp and amongst other things as well in terms of that regard. Now, I know the social sector's coming to come together in terms of that. I mean, I have got meetings coming up with other stakeholders in the private sector to talk about that. I would encourage them to try and work towards that as well. So I think one of the key things is having a meeting with them is to try and establish about what support they would need from the Scottish Government in that regard, because I think the social sector took the lead in that regard. We've heard from the private sector about what they're doing, but I think it's in terms of trying to work out specifically the support they would need from that. And I think a lot of it comes back for me down to, you know, the information that can go out to residents and tenants around about that. And I think that's one of the key things, is how they try and get that information out there. Sometimes it can be easier for a social sector to send it out to 6,000, 7,000, 8,000 tenants they might have. Private sector's probably different and probably more diverse. So it's trying to meet with them and trying to understand exactly what support they would need in terms of that. I think they are working on it. In terms of that, but I think it's trying to understand exactly what they need. But I think information, where we can assist them with, I think is a key aspect of that.
Thank you, Minister. That's me.
Sorry, just to follow up on that one, actually. At the end of the previous session, Callum was suggesting that we need all the right information in one place, not only for tenants, but also for landlords. Do you think that's something that the government could help with?
I think that's something I picked up this morning, again, coming from the last session through Callum and previous sessions in terms of that. And I think that's something that the officials and I can take away and consider in terms of that, because, you know, obviously we're trying to, you know, we've talked about the private rented sector, RSLs, the council housing and so on. So I think there's an element about how we can try and, I suppose, standardise that and try and see how much we can get that out. So again, that's something that I've certainly taken away from the evidence that's come in. And obviously I'll speak to officials about that and come back to the committee about that.
Yeah, I think also there's maybe something that's coming through around accessible language as well, isn't there?
Yeah.
So how do you make we've got the information, but is it really accessible to people when they do find it?
And I think it comes back to the point, Convener, that you mentioned before. You know, if people in certain circumstances don't feel there's any support out there, they'll tend not to look for it. So we need to try and see how we can be more proactive in that support in that regard. So I think that's an incredibly important part of looking at that.
Thanks very much. We're now going to bring in Ivan McKee.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister and panel. Two issues I was going to touch on. The first was on, if you can give us any update on the work to progress housing to 2040 and the commitment to introduce a new housing quality standard. And is that specifically going to cover the issue of dampness and mould? I know you've touched on some of the issues in your previous answers, but just on that specifically.
Yeah, I think there was a strategic board set up, Housing 2040. I think the present DFM chaired that at the first meeting in March. I'll now be chairing that group going forward. We don't have a date as of yet, but we're certainly planning to do that before the summer recess to consider about that, what's going forward. So it's very much setting out the strategic objectives at the moment. So I think that's not been discussed as such, but I think some of the issues obviously came through today will be something that will be discussed by the board itself. That will obviously be feeding in through stakeholders as well. So there's stakeholders feed into that. I'd imagine that issue would be raised in terms of that. So we're hoping to report some, I suppose, progress in that later on, back to committee and obviously to Parliament in terms of where that's going at this stage. But the next strategic meeting, I think we've just had the one meeting so far, so the next meeting will be in June, and I think, you know, I think probably progress the strategic objectives of where the board will be by that time and for Housing 2040 strategy board that looks at then. But we're hoping, as I said, to get that before the summer recess. There's plans to get that in the diary before the summer recess.
Okay, so look forward to getting an update.
Yeah, and again, we can report back to committee on that particular issue.
And the other issue was round about retrofits and the work that's going on there. and various issues in relation to tenants understanding what that that looks like, how to use new heating systems, the interplay between retrofit for net zero and insulation versus maintaining ventilation to ensure buildings are up to standard with regards to combating dampness and mould, and then standards round about contractors that are doing those retrofits with regard to some issues that have been raised on this recently. So I don't know if you can kind of give us an overview of how that looks and your thinking.
I think there's three issues, and again, you know, I mentioned what the CIH talked about. Obviously, there's looking at the repairs and, you know, where does investment go for that? Obviously, we talked about the Affordable Housing Supply Programme. Where does investment go towards that? And obviously, we talked about the retrofitting agenda as well, which I think is incredibly important. So there's two or three key things, I think, in my own head in that regard. One, obviously, we've talked about the repairs, and I think it's getting a greater understanding, particularly about damp and mould, which I think is important. The Affordable Housing Supply Programme, again, it's trying to speak to as many local authorities, because there might be different perspectives from each of the local authorities. Edinburgh and Glasgow, and having a chance to speak to them was really informative for myself in terms of where their balance kind of sits and the whole housing mix, if you like. That was including retrofitting. And again, you know, I'm really keen to go out and speak to the rural authorities as well. Do they have a different outlook and perspective on that? And where does, how can we bring forward a affordable housing supply programme on a larger scale in terms of that? So where does that fit in, for example, with retrofitting? Local authorities have to produce their LHE strategy by the end of this year. So that will kind of set out where each local authority needs to look in terms of what's required at looking at retrofitting. And that's across the private sector, the public sector, and so on, and RSLs and so on. So that, I think, will be quite informative in terms of that. There's discussions, obviously, that the Net Zero Committee had in terms of what local authorities need to do to try and deliver that programme. And I think the considerations and recommendations that came through, obviously, were for probably more the Energy Minister, but obviously very relevant to myself in terms of what do we need to do to try and support that in that regard. So that's an important fact as well. And how do we finance this? Local authority and the Scottish Government is putting £1.8 billion in this Parliament towards that. I met last week with officials from the four nations, home nations, and this was discussed. So, you know, no country can produce or have the funds to develop and support that programme over that period of time. So there's a Green Finance reporting group that reports back in, I think, to Mr Harvey in terms of how do we finance. So there's discussions as well as with the private sector and about how can they move towards a retrofitting agenda. So it's quite a mix at the moment. I think we are making progress. There'll be the heating buildings strategy that's getting developed at the moment in terms of that through Mr Harvey. So, but I think it's trying to understand where the mix is in terms of each local authority. But it is looking at repairing standards, it is looking at retrofitting, and it is looking at the Affordable Housing Supply Programme. And within that finance packet, if you like, how do we get that balance right in each local authority and across Scotland?
Right, so in that specific question, you're comfortable that in terms of the technology, we understand that what we're doing on net zero isn't potentially exacerbating problems on dampness and mould, and there's a process for making sure contractors are up to the right standard to be able to implement the retrofit that's not going to cause any problems with regards to dampness and mould.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the key things, obviously, I don't have to reference it before, was EASH2, and looking at the standards around about that as well. And I think one of the key things at the moment is coming back to where the local authorities kind of doing them through the local, you know, the LHE strategy. I think that's incredibly important when they're looking at now. The LHE strategy looks around about, if I take East Lothian for my own local authority, you know, there's a lot of rural housing. So how do we make sure there's a systems in there that don't exacerbate damp and mould in terms of that? So what they'll be bringing through the LHE strategy, we'll be trying to say, right, what's the technology that's relevant for each part? So, and that might be the same in tenements, for example, in Glasgow. So I think part of that work that's going on in about the LHE strategy, which is due out by the end of the year, will be around about what's the relevant technology for the relevant part of the country. And I mean, I suppose you're looking at climate, you're talking about how rural is it, you know, we're talking about obviously tenements in Glasgow. So it's, the LHE strategy will be a really incredibly important part of what each local authority is doing in that regard, and obviously then how that would set out what technology that they use.
Okay, that's good. Thank you.
Thanks, Ivan. I'm just going to come back to the housing standard. You've talked about the new housing standard. So obviously we have a housing standard now, and I'd be interested to hear how do we currently enforce that standard, and if we bring a new one in, how do we ensure that that's actually being met by housing companies?
I think we obviously mentioned before around about, I mean, the Scottish Housing Quality Standard obviously is there at the moment. We kind of discussed on around about how that's kind of measured, and there, suppose there is that onus on local authorities and private landlords, and obviously in RSLs to look at that. I think part of the discussions that coming back about the new housing standard, the board has met once. The Housing to 2040 board has met once. The housing standards, you know, was something that was going to be brought forward by the government in that regard. So there is work being progressed at that stage. And again, that would be something that, you know, we would feed back to the committee on that particular regard. I think, again, it's engaging with stakeholders in terms of that. And I think it would be one of the issues that would certainly be raised in June meeting that we're planning to have in that regard. But I think we are progressing work around about, we talked about before, around about this Parliament looking at a null tenure standard. In terms of that, and there's work being progressed at this moment, but I think in terms of taking that forward and the standards in terms of that, I think would be worth something. It would come back to the committee at that particular stage. So it's an early progress at the moment, but I think getting the feedback from stakeholders is incredibly important in how we develop that policy, taking it forward.
So you talk about raising stakeholder awareness around housing standards. What will you, and you're going to have a meeting, what kinds of things do you think is important to raise with them or have them become more aware of?
I think there are a number of things. I think we talked about this morning around about one of it was about information and what's out there. I think in terms of the reporting, I think was another issue that kind of came back. And one of the key things that kind of struck me this morning was around about the collaborative approach, you know, from the CIH, from the regulator, from what government is doing. So, you know, it's trying to make sure that we're all working together on that one, and that's joining the dots in that regard. I think that's really important. What does an alternative standard look like as well, I think, is an important part of what we need to do going forward. And I think, as I said, coming back to the Housing to 2040 board, I think there's the stakeholder involvement at an early stage, I think, is incredibly important as we develop that. I mean, we talked about this morning, and it comes back to Mr Coffey's point around about Timmy's approach to it. And I think that would be certainly something I think that stakeholders would discuss, and, you know, and we talked around about that, and the regulator talked around about what they would be doing around about their guidelines. So I think as other bodies develop their thoughts, you know, we'll obviously be working very closely with them in that regard.
Thanks very much for that. I think that concludes our questions. And I just want to say what I'm noting is that it is really great to have a Minister for Housing. I think we've been missing that in the committee. So thank you so much, because I think we're able to get a depth, deeper into the issues that we need to address here. So very much appreciate your coming and giving us your evidence.
I know I'm back in a few weeks' time, so and it's another really important issue.
It's also very good to hear that you are actually proactively getting out and talking to all local authorities, and that you really understand that housing issues in Scotland are different in different parts of Scotland, to do with climate, geography, all countless things. So, tremendous to have you in this role.
Okay. Thanks, Camilla. Thank you, Pam.
As we previously agreed to take item 3 in private, I now close the public part of the meeting.